Before we begin, make sure to smash that like button, subscribe to our channel, and click the notification bell for more amazing videos.
Teen Lifeguard's unsolved murder case is cracked open with unexpected evidence. 20 years of crumbling clues and false leads brought nothing but disappointment to the family of Molly Bish, whose sudden disappearance in the year 2000 sent the community of Warren, Massachusetts into high alert. Eventually, interest in the case dwindled as it became more likely that Molly would never be found alive. Molly's family, however, refused to give up hope, and although time didn't heal their wounds, it ended up cracking open a huge hole in the case. Ironically, the Bishes moved to Warren, Massachusetts out of concern for their children's safety. They'd lived in Detroit until a violent crime occurred in their neighborhood, when a woman walking home was kidnapped and murdered. The Bishes relocated to Warren, where they lived comfortably for 15 years. Their daughter Molly was 16 when she was hired as a lifeguard in Commons Pond. The pond wasn't exactly a picturesque vacation spot. It was in a heavily wooded area and fairly secluded from the rest of the community. Still, it was a place to have fun. No one worried about anything dangerous happening there. The only real danger, people thought, was drowning, which is why Molly was there in the first place. So when Maggie, Molly's mother, dropped her daughter off for work on June 27, 2000, she did so without hesitation. And when her phone rang 3 hours later, Maggie certainly didn't expect the voice on the other end to be a police officer. She heard the words every mother dreads hearing, "Your daughter is missing." Molly's lifeguarding equipment, including her shoes, were still at the pool, but the police couldn't locate the lifeguard herself. Maggie and her husband John knew immediately that something was very, very wrong. Alarm bells went off in the parents' heads. It was unlike Molly to ditch work early, let alone without her shoes, and without telling anyone where she was going. Maggie and John had the horrible feeling that something had happened to Molly, something out of her control. The police, however, thought otherwise. Since there was no obvious sign of a struggle, the police didn't immediately suspect foul play. Weeks passed without any resolution as they searched the wilderness surrounding Commons Pond. Meanwhile, Maggie replayed the days leading up to Molly's disappearance in her mind. With a jolt, she remembered something odd. Maggie remembered an odd moment a few days before Molly's disappearance. She dropped Molly off at work when she noticed a man sitting in a white car in the pond's parking lot. "I'm kind of nervous, thinking, what's this guy doing? Why isn't he at work?" Maggie later said. "Because we're in a small town, people will kind of say hi or just nod their head, but this guy just stared at me." The brief interaction had sent a chill down Maggie's spine, and she couldn't get it out of her mind in the weeks following Molly's disappearance. Something told her that the mysterious man was connected to her daughter. Not long after she had this revelation, Maggie learned a disturbing fact. The same man had been seen in the lot on the day of Molly's disappearance. What was strange, however, was how the man left the parking lot just before Maggie and Molly arrived. Impatient with the police, the Bishes did what they could to bring more attention to Molly's case and to the mysterious man. They created a website and set up an email chain to raise awareness. In 2001, Maggie met with Gene Boylan, a famous sketch artist, to draw a composite of the man Maggie saw in the parking lot. Gene and Maggie collaborated for 9 hours on the drawing. When Gene was finished, Maggie looked at the drawing and felt certain that Gene had perfectly captured the suspect's likeness, even including the cigarette he smoked as he stared at the mother dropping off her daughter for work. The man was about 50 with brown hair and intense eyes. Gene's composite sketch was given to police and distributed around the area. Even with the Bishes doing so much on their own to add to the investigation, authorities weren't any closer to identifying the man in the white car. Cops checked on local sex offenders, which led to more of the same. Nothing. Molly wasn't the only girl to disappear from Warren either. In 1993, 10-year-old Holly Piranin, whose family lived in the Warren area, was kidnapped and murdered. After years of work, investigators named David Pouliot as Holly's murderer, using newly recovered forensic evidence. They never filed any charges against David, who died in 2003. Meanwhile, in 2003, the Bishes finally got news. But it wasn't good. Molly's remains were recovered in Hampton County, a neighboring community to Warren. It was clearer than ever that before that, Molly had been murdered, but her case went cold. Years passed during which the Bishes lived with more questions than answered. Technology hadn't yet caught up to the changing times until 2016. That's when police finally obtained better technology to test 24 pieces of evidence from Molly's case for traces of DNA. For the first time in decades, the Bishes had hope. They knew the chances of finding their daughter alive were slim to none, but with this new technology on their side, they could finally answer questions that had been plaguing them ever since June 2000. Thanks to this technology, they finally had solid leads. The police investigated a campground outside of Warren where a white Buick LeSabre was rumored to be buried, a car that they hoped could be connected to the case. They used radar technology to scan the campground for a burial site. It's unclear if the investigators uncovered anything at the campsite, but they continued to work Molly's case with renewed enthusiasm. The DNA testing went on for years. The Bishes, desperate to link a suspect to Molly's case, finally, after 2 years of testing and tip-taking, authorities publicly named a new person of interest. Multiple people gave information leading them to Francis Frank Sumner Sr. Frank lived about 20 minutes from Warren and spent most of his life in the area. To make matters even more suspicious for Sumner, the police unearthed a disturbing crime from his past. In the 80s, the then auto mechanic committed a heinous crime. He abducted and raped one of his female customers. Sumner hadn't gotten away with it. He'd spent 16 years in prison. But to the horror of the Bishes, he'd been released back into society in 1998. Molly's murder happened just 2 years later. There was another important connection the police wouldn't discover until they visited Maggie and her daughter, Dr. Heather Bish Martin. The investigative team showed Maggie and Heather a picture of Frank without warning, and their reactions told them everything they needed to know. Maggie and Heather were speechless. "We recognized all the characteristics that my mother had described for police sketches," Heather said. The police also filled the Bishes in on Frank's background. "It was terrifying," Heather said. "I mean, he's got aggravated rape and kidnapping charges. He brutally beat a woman, he stalked people, he sexually harassed people. He's scary." We might never know what exactly happened to Molly, but we can certainly conjecture what happened to her, based on some of the things he's done, Heather said. The Bishes and the Warren community waited for the police to take action against Sumner. But due to a lack of concrete evidence, Frank was never officially convicted by the team, and before they could interview him, he died. When Sumner died, so too did the family's hope of answering any questions about Molly's disappearance. Only one silver lining came from the Bishes' lifetime of suffering. "We are proud of Molly's legacy of keeping children safe, advocating for families, and we feel it most strongly now, reflected in our community," Maggie and John said. "And with technology always advancing, there's still some hope that Molly's case won't be cold forever. Stranger things have happened, after all. Please share this with your friends and family."